This is a letter from a 95-year-old Pearl Harbor survivor. Dear President Obama, my name is Harold Estes, approaching 95 on December 13th this year. People meeting me for the first time don't believe my age because I remain wrinkle-free and pretty much mentally alert. I enlisted in the U.S. Navy in 1934 and served proudly before, during, and after World War II, retiring as a Master Chief Bos'n Mate. Now I live in a rest home, quote-unquote, located on the western end of Pearl Harbor, allowing me to keep alive the memories of 23 years of service to my country. One of the benefits of my age, perhaps the only one, is to speak my mind, blunt and direct, even to the head man. So here goes. I am amazed, angry and determined not to see my country die before I do, but you seem hell-bent not to grant me that wish. I can't figure out what country you are the president of. You fly around the world telling our friends and enemies despicable lies like, and I quote, "We're no longer a Christian nation. America is arrogant," unquote. Your wife even announced to the world, quote, "America is mean-spirited," unquote. Please tell her to try preaching that nonsense to 23 generations of our war dead buried all over the globe who died for no other reason than to free a whole lot of strangers from tyranny and hopelessness. I'd say shame on both of you, but I don't think you like America, nor do I see an ounce of gratefulness in anything you do, for the obvious gifts this country has given you. To be without shame or gratefulness is a dangerous thing for a man sitting in the White House. After 9/11, you said, quote, "America hasn't lived up to her ideals," unquote. Which ones did you mean? Was it the notion of personal liberty that 11,000 farmers and shopkeepers died for to win independence from the British? Or maybe the ideal that no man should be a slave to another man, that 500,000 men died in the Civil War? I hope you didn't mean the ideal 470,000 fathers, brothers, husbands, and a lot of fellas I knew personally died for in World War II. Because we felt real strongly about not letting any nation push us around, because we stand for freedom. I don't think you mean the ideal that says equality is better than discrimination. You know the one that a whole lot of white people understood when they helped you get elected? Take a little advice from a very old geezer, young man. Shape up and start acting like an American. If you don't, I'll do what I can to see you get shipped off that fancy rental on Pennsylvania Avenue. You were elected to lead, not to bow, apologize, and kiss the hands of murderers and corrupt leaders who still treat their people like slaves. And just who do you think you are telling the American people not to jump to conclusions and condemn the Muslim major who killed 13 of his fellow soldiers and wounded dozens more? You mean you don't want us to do what you did when the white cop used force to subdue that black college professor in Massachusetts who was putting up a fight? You don't mind offending the police, calling them stupid, but you don't want us to offend the Muslim fanatics by calling them what they are? Terrorists? One more thing. I realize you never served in the military and never had to defend your country with your life. But you're the commander-in-chief now, son. Do your job. When your battle-hardened field general asks you for 40,000 more troops to complete the mission, give them to him. But if you're not in the fight to win, then get out. The life of one American soldier is not worth the best political strategy you're thinking of. You could be our greatest president because you faced the greatest challenge ever presented to any president. You're not going to restore American greatness by bringing back our bloated economy. That's not our greatest threat. Losing the heart and soul of who we are as Americans is our big fight now. And I sure as hell didn't want to think my president is the enemy in this final battle. Sincerely, Harold B. Estes.